The Milky Way is reportedly invisible to 99% of the U.S. population and 80% of the world population as a result of light blocking out the stars. Jason Kendall is an adjunct professor of astronomy at William Paterson University, board member of the Amateur Astronomers Association of New York, but he's our favorite star man. Jason Kendall, welcome back.
Hey, it's good to be back.
You know, this this light business is really, really serious in terms of cutting off our connection to the heavens. Tyson talks about it. You've talked about it.
Yes.
I mean, you travel around to try to escape the light. You're kind of a vampire.
Yeah, I kind of am a little bit of a vampire. I do go lots of different places. I was just up at Cherry Springs State Park, which is in northwestern Pennsylvania, about a week and a half ago, which is a dark sky location. And you can actually get lost trying to count the stars up there. And the Milky Way is absolutely clear. You can see the Great Northern Coal Sack. You can see the division inside the Milky Way. You can see nebula naked eye, like the Lagoon and the Eagle Nebula. Those are visible there, and they're very low in the sky. But it's absolutely an astonishing thing. I don't think that anybody probably understands just how much they're missing until they go see it. And then they just are stunned by it. They're stunned by what they see and the wonder that comes with it.
This is different than, you know, looking at the moon through binoculars or dragging a telescope out to see nebula and stuff. You can see this all with the naked eye.
Absolutely.
This is what the, you know, pharaohs looked at on top of the pyramids.
Absolutely.
And we don't have access to it because we have to go to these dark sky locations. How difficult are they to get to?
Actually, some of them are relatively easy. Cherry Springs is only about a 4.5-5 hour drive from New York City, and it's pretty easy to get to. There's some other places that where you can see the Milky Way, where it's still got sky brightness, like Western New Jersey at UACNJ, which is an astronomy club.
And part of this story is not just a, oh, well, we've ruined the Earth in another way once again. NASA and other government organizations and scientific organizations have created an atlas that not only plots the light pollution, but also tells us the places where we can go to see the sky, because there are plenty of places on Earth to actually see it. It's just that we humans are crowded together in places where you can't.
That's right. I mean, don't get me wrong, when we live in the city, that's where everything's really happening. But sometimes what you need to do is to get for your soul to get out of that hubbub and that motion of the day, because there's something very different between the day and the night. And the day energy is extraordinarily different than your night, quote, energy, however you want to put it. But you feel differently. Your home runs are different. Everything is different. And so experiencing night is fundamentally human. It's really who, it's another side of us. Even when we think about people like Joe Campbell, who talked about the hero's journey, I actually felt that like 2 years ago up at Cherry Springs. I was there, I stayed up all night, dusk to dawn, and I felt like I was taking this journey with the paths of the stars as I actually watched them move. You don't notice the sun moving through the day, but you always notice the stars as they rise. And that's something you can't not see when you're in a dark place.
You are a vampire, Jason Kendall. How long does it take your eyes to get used to the darkness? I mean, a lot of people feel like, oh, they go out into the country and they look up at the stars on their way into the house and they go, oh, that's so beautiful. Right. But if you stay there for a while, it gets multiple times more profound.
That's right. It takes about 15 to 20 minutes to get good and dark adapted, but about an hour later, it gets even better. So you have these layers of vision. And it's what's beautiful about it is that you're actually using very low light aspects of your eye. And so you're using the aspects of your eye that are very good at detecting line and shape and movement.
I love this. So in 15 minutes, it's really great. But then after an hour, it's really, really great. And this is all completely legal.
Exactly. That's what's funny is that people like to go out and say, oh, let's do this and do that. But I found people when they do that, they actually stop. I mean, when you get to a place, it's like, why bother having some sort of mixture in you when you can actually just see what you actually really can see and the change.
Stone cold sober. Keep it that way. The Stonehenge. Before we go, what dark sky did you grow up with?
I grew up in Springfield, Illinois, and from my front porch in the downtown of the capital of Illinois, I was able to see it. That was late 1970s.
Jason Kendall, an adjunct professor of astronomy at William Paterson University, urging us to get outside in the dark, away from the light to see the heavens. He's a board member of the Amateur Astronomers Association of New York. And your nephew is driving up?
Yes, my nephew Nathan is driving up to grab a telescope.
And you're going to give him your old 15-incher?
Yes, he's coming on up with his brother, and I'm giving him my 15-inch telescope, which just sounds like a crazy thing, and it is. But it's staying in the family, which is a wonderful thing.
Beautiful, beautiful.